Hi everyone! This week I'm going to be doing a French Foreign Legionnaire figure for you. And a big reason that I chose that particular type was that I've been really, I think, kind of neglecting certain periods recently. You've probably noticed that like World War II and the Napoleonic Wars and things like that get a lot of coverage on this channel, and there's a reason for that. It's because you guys are really interested in those periods and obviously want to see more about them. But at the same time, I like to have a balanced coverage of different periods on my video series. And there are certain eras that I feel like really don't get very much love, and most of the 19th century, especially the late 19th century, is one of those kind of times that I am really not covered very much. Kind of everything after the Civil War. And it's not for lack of fighting and wars going on, because there was plenty of that, but I just haven't done very much with figures from that time. And so that's why I thought, well, a French Foreign Legionnaire, that's sort of that like very typical, sort of one of those classic types of soldiers that was really famous at the end of the 19th century. You know, for their exploits, their adventures, they kind of typify that era, I think, in some ways. So, that's what I'm going to be doing for you. The figure here I'm going to be using is this guy. He is from the North Star, or I should say Artizan, March or Die range. They do a good big selection of French Foreign Legionnaires, kind of from the last decade or so of the 19th century, sort of also the early 20th century. And there's a lot of choice here, but I really, as you know, really like Artizan figures because of their proportions, kind of their build. In fact, I think they paint up very easily. So that's a big reason that I've chosen him. And the uniform that this particular guy has got is going to be a blue and white one. Obviously, the Legionaries have had a variety of different uniforms through the years. More khaki, brown, simple uniforms. They had, I think, a red uniform at times. But this particular guy is going to be doing the blue and white uniform variant that seems to have been used at that time. And I, of course, think dark blue and white is a really pretty combination. So it should be fun to paint. And I've already done a fair amount of white painting on this channel. Maybe not always in big amounts, but I've been doing it. And each time I kind of do it a little bit differently, because I'm always just kind of messing around, experimenting, trying to find other ways that you can paint white and get a good effect. So I'll probably be doing that again here. I'll be trying out a slightly different technique, doing the white a little bit different than in other earlier videos, just to see, you know, try to get maybe not better results necessarily, but at least ones that are different. And so, you know, they may be better or work out more for some people or some projects. So hopefully that's going to be interesting and it'll, you know, provide good results. Otherwise, this is a reasonably simple figure. It shouldn't be too complicated or take a great deal of time. All right, so I'm going to go ahead now and get started. And I'm going to start by painting the white areas on the uniform first. Mostly because I want to get white out of the way, but also because things like the pants here are kind of on the sort of lowest level of the sculpt, so it makes sense to do them right away. And I'm going to also be painting the inner flaps of his coat because those are white, and also the cover on top of his hat. And I'm just base coating all these with Vallejo Sky Gray, which you can see is very similar to my base undercoat color. I'm now going to apply a very, very light wash to the white areas, and I've made this by mixing Nuln oil with Agrax Earthshade, and then I've watered it down a lot. And you can see just how thin it is here, because you can see that it's really not changing the color more than just a little subtly. The brown is in there basically to keep the color from feeling just too stark, to warm it up just a teeny tiny bit. The main thing you want to make sure doesn't happen here is that your wash pools too much. You want to get it nice and smooth, and you know, once it's dry, you can also go back and build it up a little bit extra in some of the shadow areas, like between his legs. Now for this approach that I'm taking to white, I'm only going to be using one color, and that is white. And to start out, what I've done is taken just some Vallejo white and I've thinned it down a lot. So not just thin enough that it flows well, but a bit thinner than that, so it gets really extra transparent here. And the reason I'm doing that is so that I can just use the white as my only color and just keep building it up over the gray to get sort of different shades. And for my first layer, I'm going to be putting the white pretty much everywhere, very thinly. And that will make sure that we have sort of a smooth, even layer to work from as we sort of build up. And but it's so thin and transparent right now that a lot of that gray base coat, some of the shading, some of the wash we just put on is really going to still show through, but the white over top will make sure that it's even. Now remember, when you've got paint and it's this thin down, it can have a tendency to not go on evenly. You can get some areas that may be more pigmented than others, so it's very important when you're putting these thin layers down to make sure you spend time smoothing them and making sure that each layer is even. It may not be as heavy as you want, but it's more important that your layers are even and that they get as much color on as you would like. And I'm going to then, once I put one layer everywhere, I'm going to go back in again and start building the white up on areas where I am planning to, you know, highlight and have it get lighter. So you can see sort of on the creases, the tops of creases and folds, sort of the fronts of areas where light is hitting. And then areas like in between his legs where it gets more shadowed, I'm going to build up less layers there. And obviously on his hat too, there's going to need to be quite a few layers because that's really getting hit by a lot of light. But we want our shading on a lot of those areas to still be present, but just quite subtle. And I'm going to be taking this very, very thin down white, and I'm going to be making, probably at least 2 to 3 passes over all the white areas with it, just gradually adding more and gradually lightening it more and more and more. You know, just until I'm starting to, you know, really start to see a real difference. And because this white is so thin, you will notice that it never really gets really bright white. It's just gonna, at most, it's sort of gonna be sort of a light gray color. And then once I've accomplished a sort of subtle shading using that very thin down white paint, I'm then gonna take another mix of white paint. It's still white paint, but I am just going to add enough water to it so that it flows nicely, but still pretty thick and pretty pigmented. Well, as pigmented as white paint ever gets, I suppose. And I'm going to be using that now instead because it'll go a lot faster. I mean, you could just keep going with the very thin white paint, but it'll take you much longer. So if you sort of halfway through switch to a thicker, heavier white paint, and then start using that to really put on the high highlights, you then can just continue what you were doing, but then you won't need to make quite so many passes with this, and you can really start building it up where light is really, really hitting the figure. But because we spent so much time building those sort of subtle layers up with that sort of gray and thin down white, this thicker white that we're now putting on the higher is just gonna blend in very smoothly and nicely to that that shade that we did before, but it's going to just brighten and lighten quicker. And as you see, as I progress here and make more and more passes, I'm going to be putting the white on increasingly smaller areas and you know, just keep it kind of going along like that. And remember, of course, even white when it's thick is quite a transparent color, so to get it really brilliantly white is really going to take you quite a bit of time. But that's just the nature of white. And in some ways that's what you want, because white is one of those colors where if you have too much of stark contrast when you're shading, it's not really gonna look like white. It's gonna look more like gray, and that's not the effect we want. A good white color is always going to be really nice and subtle, and you can see that that's what we're getting here. So I would say this technique for painting white is very effective. It'll give you a really nice, subtle, smooth looking shaded white color, but it may not be as fast as an approach as some others just because of the number of layers you have to put on. On the other hand, you don't have to mix paint at all when you're doing this. It's just one color applied over and over and over again. I'm pretty happy with the white area, so now I'm going to work on the blue overcoat. The overcoat that the Legionnaires wore at this period was a very deep blue, but it was rather, I guess, a little bit lighter and a little bit grayer than their uniform coat was here. The base I'm using is a mixture of dark Prussian blue with some black, so we get a really nice dark base to work from. The main thing that you need to be careful about here is that you don't make a mess on your
white that you've already painted, and that's can be a little bit bigger order than you think, because when you're working with a really dark color like this and you've already got some really light color down, it can be kind of fussy not to, you know, get any of the paint where you want it, and you want a nice smooth defined line in between the two areas that's even. So just put the base coat down, but just be very careful that you don't make a mess on those areas that you've already done. My first highlight on the coat is going to be a mixture of the dark Prussian blue and some Oxford blue. And I'm going to be using Oxford blue primarily to lighten up this coat, because it's a nice sort of blue-gray color. You could use the Luftwaffe uniform blue too, but it's a little bit grayer than the Oxford blue, and so I sort of prefer this. And once you've got the base coat down, it's going to be a lot easier to apply these layers without making a mess. And actually, at least on this figure anyway, it's done such so you can actually apply the layers here pretty quickly, and you know, just because there's so many areas are just sort of concealed. I also wanted to point out here that the canteen on this figure is going to be painted the same blue as the coat, so that's going to save you a little bit of time. And then I'm just going to add even more Oxford blue into that mixture that I had, just lightening it up even further, and just repeat the process of applying it to the coat, but just, as you'd expect, applying it to increasingly sort of lighter areas and, you know, just putting it in less places. And of course, make sure that all the seams and the coat and anything like that, you stay away from those. Make sure deep creases and seams, you know, keep the really dark black color from the base. And in this next step, I've actually just taken pure Oxford blue and just mixed a teeny tiny bit of the dark Prussian blue in there just to darken it ever so slightly, but mostly just to keep it sort of tonally consistent. And I'm just now just repeating the process that I already did. And you can see I'm applying it pretty much all over, but just a little bit less than in the last step, basically. Sort of the final process on highlighting the coat involves taking some of that Vallejo Sky Gray and mixing it into that sort of Oxford blue mix that we already had. And you can see this is now quite a bit lighter, and I'm going to be applying it now really to areas where I want to emphasize where there's light hitting. Sort of, as you can see, I really start at the edges of the coat or the edges of seams, and you can see I apply the strongest amount there, and then I pull it and blend it outwards from there as I go, so that it sort of fades and becomes less sort of a strong color. And it, you know, if you feel like when you pull and blend it outwards, it gets too weak on the area where you initially applied it, don't worry about that too much. You can always go back in once it's dry and just reapply another coat on the most extreme areas, and you won't really even have to blend that time because of the fact that, you know, you've already got that sort of blended out layer there, and, you know, you can just strengthen the color that you already have. So yeah, I'm just going to be putting this all over and, as I said, focusing on all the edges and high creases. And then to finish off, just as one more detail, I'm going to add even more sky gray into my mixture, and that's going to be very light, and I'm going to use that really just as an edge highlight only at that point. So it's going to go on all of the edges of the clothing, along all of the seams, and on the very sharp creases that you can kind of see around his collar and around on his sleeves, you know, where his arms are really bent, and you really want to emphasize that. But if you only use it as an edge highlight, you shouldn't have to do too much blending, because it'll just kind of merge pretty seamlessly with that light color that we've really already applied. Now I'm going to start working on the leather areas of this figure, and the French Foreign Legionnaire from this period is kind of easy from that perspective, because all of his leather bits were basically black, with maybe the exception of his gun strap, but this particular model, his strap isn't really attached, so you don't have to worry about it. So you want to base coat everything with just black paint, and that's going to include here his boots, all of his equipment straps, any sort of pouches that he's wearing on his belt, and of course the brim of his hat, which is sticking out from underneath the white cover. The only strap you're not going to want to paint is the one on his sort of canvas mess bag because it's canvas and the strap is also canvas, so you can just ignore that for the moment. I'm then going to apply pretty overall highlight to all the black leather areas of German gray, and as you can see, I'm really putting this pretty much everywhere. I'm just kind of not putting it on some of the really deep shadow recesses and wherever there's any sort of seams or dividing lines in the equipment pieces. I'm now going to lighten the German gray up a little bit by mixing in just a little tiny bit of the scry gray. It doesn't even have to be scry gray, just any really light gray color will do because the German gray is so dark, pretty much anything lightens it. But the first highlight I'm putting on here, it should be pretty subtle. You don't want it to be a big step upwards. And you can see I'm going to just be applying it areas where I want light to be hitting, especially sort of the tops of pieces, along all the edges, and on the boots, of course, things like the toes and the heels and the backs of his calves. And, you know, areas obviously that are in a lot of shadow or between his legs or something, you don't have to really apply this color that much. And then once I've gotten that everywhere, I'm just going to add even more of the light gray into that mix that I've already got and go up basically another step with my gray highlighting. And it's the same deal. I'm going to be focusing on the same places, but just a little bit less in, you know, smaller areas and on areas where I want even more extreme highlights. So it's just, you know, kind of it's a sort of a progressively less and less kind of thing. And now to get a little bit more of a leather effect, I've taken some Vallejo leather brown, very obvious there, and I've made it very thin, so kind of like a wash really, and I'm going to be applying it in a very transparent way to areas where I think the leather might be a little bit worn from him handling it or on the tips and heels of his boots where, you know, he's going to be rubbing against things. And I'm just going to apply this very thinly so you can see it becomes slightly brown, but really a lot of the initial highlighting shading shows through. And this is just nice because it makes the pieces look a little bit more like leather, you know, adding that sort of warmth to them. And you can even apply a couple of layers, especially to areas where you think there'd be a lot of wear, like on his boots, and then just use a very light wash on some areas just to give the indication of that leather color. I'm going to be base coating his mesh bag here using Iraqi sand. I've seen this painted white too, but I wanted to use a slightly different color here just for some variety because he's so, you know, black, blue, white, you know, you just want to get a little bit of something different in there. And Iraqi sand, you know, that's going to be a nice base for sort of a canvas kind of color. Don't forget, of course, to get his strap where the mesh bag goes over his shoulder as well. And then I'm going to wash the whole thing all over pretty heavily here with some Agrax Earth Shade, which will help get, you know, some definition down in the creases and folds. Once the wash is dry, I'm going to go back over it again with some thinned down Iraqi sand and just kind of re-highlight over the areas where I want brighter color. Because I darken it so much with that wash, you can just use the color that you had before and you can see it makes a huge difference. And I'm applying it fairly lightly and layering it a little bit, you know, applying several layers so that I can get some more interesting tones going on, a little bit of extra variation. And then I'm going to finish the mess bag by mixing a bit of white into my Iraqi sand so I get kind of a very light cream color. And I'm just going to use this to highlight, you know, the highest areas, the tops of kind of sharp folds and creases, and along any sort of edges or things like that. And I'm going to apply it thinly at first to blend it out a little bit and then gradually build it up so it's really quite strong on some of the most exposed, sort of sharp areas of the bag. And now for the stock of his rifle, I'm going to be using the color combinations that I usually go with here. So I'm going to start with a base coat here of German Camouflage Black Brown, which you're just going to want to put on all of the wood areas quite generously. And then I'm going to take some Foundry Chestnut Shade, and I'm going to start layering that onto all the wood areas. And by that I mean that I'm going to apply it very thinly at first and sort of build it up so that it's stronger and brighter on sort of edge areas and the like. And this is not so very difficult to do because this paint is fairly transparent. It layers very nicely. You don't really have to blend it too much to be able to build it up in this way. And then as usual, I'm gonna finish up doing that same technique, but now with chestnut medium. And I'm gonna always start by applying it to all of the sharpest edges of the gun and sort of pulling it out from there. And I'm gonna apply a couple of layers, just repeating that process over and over again until I'm happy with it. And remember, you want the wood to be kind of bright and light, so don't worry if you put too much of this color down. Now finally for the metal areas on the rifle. This particular model that he's using here, most of the metal parts are exposed, so you can see the entire rifle barrel. It's not covered in wood. And the action, that whole thing, there's sort of a metal plate that kind of covers sort of both sides of the gun. So you're gonna have quite a bit to do here. Well, relatively, I guess. Anyway, I'm using here a mixture of German gray and some Vallejo Air gunmetal. Obviously, you want mostly gray and just a little bit of gunmetal for this base coat layer. And now I'm just gonna take some thinned down pure gunmetal, and I'm gonna use that to very gently highlight all the areas of the gun, especially where light is hitting or, you know, you expect there to be some extra reflection or something. And you should keep this thin when you put it down initially, just so you don't get it too shiny right away. And if you like, you can then add more layers to brighten up certain areas where you want there to be a lot of wear. Okay, and here is our sort of finished French Legionnaire from the sort of late 19th, early 20th century period. I'm very happy with how this came out, and a lot of that has to do with the fact that I just like painting these artisan figures because they're really sort of to my taste. I mean, he's obviously a simple figure. He didn't really take very long, but you may have noticed that I spent quite a lot of time on the white and the blue of his uniform. And as I've mentioned in earlier videos, when you've got a very simple, straightforward figure like this, it pays to put a little bit more effort and pay a little bit more attention to painting the fabrics and those sorts of things, because there's going to be less to look at on the figure, sort of less details and other things to, you know, kind of distract the eye. So people are really going to focus on those pieces. So it's important that you paint them well, you know. So in some ways, simple figures are actually can be more work if you want them to look good. One thing I really liked on this figure was how the white came out. I think it's a beautiful, subtle, smooth effect, and I liked how few kinds of paint I need to use and how little mixing I needed to do with the paint, which is always a plus. Of course, the downside was it took a lot of time. Okay, not lots of time, but there was quite a bit of a time investment in applying all of the layers of white that you need for this technique to work. But, you know, I think if you want a figure like this where, you know, the white is really important on the figure, it really stands out and it needs to really, really look good and it's not just some little detail piece, then, you know, investing that extra time is really important so that you get something, you know, that really looks good. So, as usual, I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, please like it, share it. Leave me comments on what you thought, and of course you can also subscribe to my channel if you have not done so already. It's always helpful to me when you do that. And I think that's all for now, and I will see you next time.